The following program contains language which some people may consider unsuitable for younger and more sensitive viewers.
Apollo 13 to the Edge and Back was provided in part by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by annual financial support from viewers like you.
The moon has immense power. It moves oceans. It pulls at lovers' hearts. We pray to it and stand awed by its eclipses. In the 1960s, it became a target, the focus of a military and political competition between rival superpowers. America's effort to be first to the moon was called Apollo, after the Greek god who drove his chariot to the sun. Apollo let us feel the wonder and triumph of man's first steps into the galaxy. It also introduced us to a new fear. On Apollo 13, disaster struck, and three men faced being lost forever in the dark, cold void of space. Their story is one of the great adventures in the history of exploration and discovery. April 11th, 1970. Three men suit up for a voyage that will end up as perilous as any taken by Columbus or Magellan. They are the crew of Apollo 13. The commander is Jim Lovell. The 42-year-old father of four is one of the most experienced astronauts in the world. Lovell and 36-year-old lunar module pilot Fred Hayes will walk on the moon's surface. Hayes, a rookie, is leaving a pregnant wife and three children at home. Command module pilot Jack Swigert, 38, and another first-timer, is the only bachelor astronaut. He's a last-minute replacement for another astronaut who was exposed to the measles. All three are experienced test pilots. They're used to taking risks.
That's the kind of people we wanted in that place when we selected them. Guys that are used to putting their lives on the line every day and knowing every minute, every second that they fly, that they are apt to be in a position where if they do something wrong or something bad happens, they're allowed to be dead.
6 hours before liftoff, Jim Lovell leads the way out to the rocket.
We got in the van, drove down to the big Saturn V. This thing is loaded with about 5.5 million pounds of high explosives, and consequently, everybody else is about 3.5 miles away. We went up the elevator all by ourselves, up this gantry that's usually filled with people during the test phase and, you know, the construction. Right next to me, of course, was this huge Saturn V. Near the top of it, it was spewing out gaseous oxygen, almost like it was alive. And I looked down at the ground and 330 feet below, and then it suddenly dawned on me, my gosh, these people are going to send us to the moon.
As Lovell, Hayes, and Swigert enter the capsule that will take them to the moon, they know success depends on intricate teamwork and flawless machinery. What they don't know is this machine is flawed. Less than 10 feet below the crew's couches, deep within the service module, there are cracked wires in an oxygen tank. The tank is now full of liquid oxygen, which is all that's preventing a spark that could cause an explosion.
14, 13, 12, 11, 10, 9, 8. Ignition sequence has started. 6, 5.
Liftoff for Apollo 13 is at 13:13 Houston time. Some in the crowd find all the 13s an ominous portent, but NASA refuses to pay it any mind. The launch goes smoothly. In 3.5 days, Lovell and Hayes should be on the moon, collecting rock samples, testing for signs of volcanic activity, and continuing the search for signs of life.
Houston, you're looking good.
Roger.
For an old hand like Jim Lovell, it feels good to be back in space.
The sights, the sounds, the smells, the stars, they all were very, very familiar to me. I really sort of enjoyed being up there again. I sort of enjoyed, you know, being the sort of the narrator, the guide for the other two guys, telling what's going on. Of course, I was more or less businesslike. Well, they kept looking at me like, you know, oh, this guy's been here before, doggone it, but we haven't. We're going to enjoy this.
Rookies Hayes and Swigert quickly settle in. To Hayes, the cabin has a familiar feel.
I don't know how many hours I spent in training in a command module, but it was, the capsule was not an unfamiliar place to be. It was a very comfortable place, the right place to be.
After a brief stay in Earth orbit, the crew fires the Saturn's third stage and heads off for the moon. On the ground at Mission Control in Houston, the men who will be working this flight are also settling in. Gene Kranz is the lead flight director.
The spacecraft is moving 5 miles a second in Earth orbit and 7 miles a second to and from the moon. So you cover an awful lot of territory in a very short period of time. So we always try to use every second, every minute when things are going right to individually prepare ourselves for what is coming next. Everything has to go perfectly in this business, and it's up to us to steer it in the path so that that happens.
Through the first day, everything is working perfectly. Even Jim Lovell's cassette tape player.
This little tape recorder has been a big benefit to us in passing some of the time away in our transit out to the moon. And it's rather odd to see it floating like this in Odyssey while it's playing the scene from 2001.
Things are so relaxed, Fred Hayes takes to playing practical jokes on his crewmates. His favorite is pushing the repressurization valve, which produces a loud bang in the spacecraft.
Stand by one. Yeah, I got him with the cabin repress valve. Every time he does that, our hearts jump in our mouth.
Lovell got his chance to go to the moon because America feared the Soviet Union would capture the high ground of space. That seemed likely in the midst of the Cold War when the Soviets launched the first artificial moon.
Today, a new moon is in the sky, a 23-inch metal sphere placed in orbit by a Russian rocket. It's a field day for the hams of
Sputnik
the world
marked the beginning of the space age. It humbled the Americans, while Soviet self-confidence and pride surged.
First of all, it was simply the proudness for the achievement of the Soviet Union. Americans are still on the ground, and we are in the space. You know, it was tremendous, tremendous psychological, I don't know how, joy, because we've done it not with anybody else, but with Americans, who were secretly always envying for his technical prowess. And now we are America.
A month later, the Soviets struck again.
A dog, a living creature far in outer space for the first time.
If the Russians could orbit a dog, they could orbit a warhead.
The heavier Mutnik, as they've nicknamed it, means Russia probably has an operational intercontinental ballistic missile. Next on Russia's space timetable could be a rocket landing on the moon. They're letting the world guess while Mutnik zooms along.
America rushed to match the Russians, but its efforts were a public relations disaster. Getting into space proved technically more complex and ultimately more risky than anyone had imagined. In 1961, the Russians once again stunned the world as cosmonaut Yuri Gagarin became the first man in space. Gagarin became the most celebrated person alive. Russian prestige reached new heights throughout the world. It took almost a year before America could match Gagarin's accomplishment.
Well, the rocket was arising, there goes our ace. Everyone was hoping that he'd go into space. As he rose higher into the sky, the clouds opened up to let John go by. Johnny Glenn, who what a man.
Glenn's flight gave all America a lift. But there was no denying that the U.S. was still stuck in second place.
You'll be sure we are behind, and will be behind for some time in manned flight. But we do not intend to stay behind, and in this decade, we shall make up and move ahead.
Determined to give the space race a finish line America could cross first, President John F. Kennedy proposed going to the moon.
We choose to go to the moon in this decade and do the other things, not because they are easy, but because they are hard.
Ихний президент Кеннеди это гениальный человек. Он понял, что
their president Kennedy, he's a genius. He understood that they needed such achievements in space that Russians would not be able to match.
Tell you the truth, I was frightened to death by that speech. I didn't know what the hell was in front of us. I never thought about the surface of the moon. I never thought about long-range communications at 270,000 miles. I'd never heard of a free return trajectory. I'd never thought about going away from this planet.
But Jim Lovell had. In fact, he'd dreamed of it since childhood. And when he was selected as one of NASA's second group of astronauts, he became one of two dozen Americans and Russians with a chance to be the first man on the moon.
Imagination can run wild, yes. Yeah. I'd love to be the first guy to land on the moon. And this was a drive, I think, that all of us had at that particular time.
Everyone is talking about spaceships. To the moon they all want to go. But there's one thing about spaceships that every girl wants to know. Oh, will there be space in a spaceship for a girl?
through the early 60s, both sides pushed hard, but the Soviets held their lead with still more space firsts. Valentina Tereshkova became the first woman in space. Konstantin Feoktistov designed and flew the first multi-person capsule.
Our bosses, they did it under the banner of a flight to the moon. It was done for prestige, because of the competition, to show we can produce a ship for several people.
Alexei Leonov made the first spacewalk. That was in 1965. And by then, the Soviet moon program looked unbeatable.
We began this program before the American colleagues. This experience we will use during our program with the landing on to the moon.
When he got back, Leonov started training for a lunar landing. He believed it was his destiny to be the first man on the moon. But it was not to be. In 1967, the Soviet moon program started to fall apart. One of their cosmonauts was killed during an emergency re-entry. Then, on three successive launch attempts, their newly designed moon rocket exploded. The Soviet moon program was grounded, though no one in the West knew it at the time. America kept pushing, and in the summer of 1969, the crew of Apollo 11, Neil Armstrong, Buzz Aldrin, and Michael Collins, headed to the moon for a rendezvous with history. Jim Lovell had been the backup pilot for this mission, but he would not realize his dream of being the first man to walk on the moon. Broadcast from the moon was fuzzy and gray, it was sufficient to allow hundreds of millions of people back on Earth to share in the wonder.
In our control mission center, all people, congratulations! And after that, we will go to a restaurant and drink some glass to health of this crew. It is according to Russian customs.
The crew of Apollo 11 was welcomed back to Earth as triumphant heroes, the personification of everything that made America great. Lovell and others in the Apollo program realized that walking on the moon could make a man a king on Earth. Apollo 13 is now 15 hours into what still appears to be a routine flight. Lovell and Hayes are just days away from joining one of history's most exclusive clubs. Only four men have walked on the moon. The crew has been drawing on oxygen tank 2 since the flight began, but the cracked wires inside are still covered. Unaware of a problem, the crew reconfigures their spacecraft for the journey to the moon. The crew sits in the conical command module. It's at the top of the rocket. Attached to it is the cylindrical service module, which supplies the command module with propulsion and electrical power and houses the oxygen tanks. After turning around, the crew docks the command module to the spider-like lunar module and extracts it from the spent rocket's third stage. Once docked, the crew can move between the two through a short tunnel. Later, Jim Lovell and Fred Hayes move through that tunnel to check out the lunar module, Aquarius. They are full of confidence and good cheer.
And now Fred's engaged with his favorite pastime.
He's not in the food locker, is he?
That's his second favorite pastime. He's rigging his hammock for sleep on the lunar surface now to try it out to see what it's going to be like.
Roger, sleeping and then eating.
Forward. 31 hours into the flight of Apollo 13, the crew prepares for a course change. In order to explore a new part of the moon, Apollo 13 will leave the free return trajectory flown by all previous missions. Getting home will now require a second rocket burn. If something goes wrong, they could drift forever in the void of space. Like everything else so far, the rocket burn goes off without a hitch. It's April 13th, and the crew of Apollo 13 is 200,000 miles from Earth, four-fifths of the way to the moon. After 55 hours, 50 minutes of flight, the cracked wires in tank 2 are now exposed. As the crew prepares to go to sleep, Mission Control radios up a routine request. Would they please turn on the fans in the oxygen tanks?
Jim was heading back into the command module, and we were going to do a little relook at checklists. This was my plan, and then ready everything and go to bed. Then we heard the bang.
A muffled type of noise. The spacecraft rocked back and forth. I could hear the jets firing because we were on an autopilot that would stabilize the ship. And then everything was quiet.
You could actually hear metallic bending noises in the tunnel area where the vehicles were still connected, but they were moving relative to each other to have caused that kind of a tin canning sound.
We looked at each other. What was it? We didn't know. I mean, nothing had come through the bulkhead. I mean, we didn't look like a meteorite hit the command module. Everything was still there. I looked at Fred, and, you know, I could tell that Fred didn't do this, didn't do anything, although he was prone to, you know, do some practical jokes by throwing a switch. He gave a similar noise, but he didn't do it this time, I could tell. I looked over at Swikert, of course, and Swikert had no idea what was going on. And about that time, a red light had come on and said something to the fact that we had lost part of our electrical system, our main bus B.
Okay, Houston, we've had a problem here.
This is Houston. Say again, please.
Houston, we've had a problem. We've had a main B bus undervolt.
Roger, main B undervolt. Okay, stand by, 13. We're looking at it.
Gene Kranz, ex-fighter pilot and one of NASA's most experienced flight directors, is on duty in mission control when the call comes in from the spacecraft.
This was what we would call, in our parlance, we'd call it a funny. It was something we didn't understand what had happened, and that is why the ground is down here. We would strip this data out, we'd look at it in recorders, we'd start figuring out what had caused the funny that we had seen. And I was sure that we would ultimately resolve the cause of this main B undervolt.
There he goes again.
Unfortunately, within moments, that funny starts to look more serious as warnings flash on screens throughout the room. Watching one of those screens is Cy Liebergott. It's his job to monitor the spacecraft's electrical system, and he can't believe what he's seeing.
I looked at my screens, and when I looked at my screens, the data said to me on the electrical power system display that I had lost the voltage on main bus B, which is one of the two main buses that feed the spacecraft, and I had lost two fuel cells. I had lost fuel cells 1 and 2. I looked at my my environmental control system cryogenics display of data, and it said I had lost O2 tank 2, and I was losing O2 tank 1. I'm looking at not a single failure, not a double failure, not a triple failure, but I'm looking at a quadruple failure. There's no possible way that could happen in this spacecraft the way it was designed.
Liebergott is convinced if that much of the spacecraft had been lost, the crew would already be dead. He concludes he's looking at an instrument problem, not real damage to the ship.
Larry, you don't believe that O2 tank 1 pressure, do you?
No. Surge tank's good. Gotcha. Manifold's good. ECS is good.
At this point, which is roughly 2 minutes in time, when I'm looking at all this, no, there's no panic. It's as you fall back upon your simulation training, and you start working the problem, and you work it the best you can.
From the moment the crew first reported the undervolt, Mission Control has assumed the problem is with the sensors monitoring hardware like the oxygen tanks. If Liebergott can prove this is so and figure out which ones have failed, a lunar landing should still be possible.
I was thinking that it was solvable, and then I was coming to the conclusion that I couldn't solve it. That wasn't a good feeling.
Can we review our status here, Si, and see what we've got from a standpoint of status? What do you think we got in the spacecraft that's good?
Kranz is, the flight director is pressing me, and to the left of my console is the Capcom console. And Jack Lausman is the Capcom, and he's responsible for keeping the crew informed, and he's feeling that we're not as forthcoming as we can be. For a very good reason we're forthcoming, because we're still trying to figure out what the hell is going on.
Okay, Com, I'm coming back to you. I assume you've called in your backup, Ecom, if we can get some more brain power in this
thing. We got one here.
Roger.
I must tell you, I have never felt in all my life as alone as I felt. This is not to denigrate the support I was getting, but I didn't have the answers, and I'm sitting there, and I felt alone.
So far, nothing the ground has suggested has helped. Jim Lovell takes another look outside.
As I looked back aft, I could see a gaseous substance escaping. It looks like a very thin haze at a very high rate of speed going out.
Something is leaking, venting out of the service module. The crew's spirits sink.
The main sense right then was I knew we lost a mission. We were going to abort and not even go into lunar orbit, much less land.
We never panicked, and people often ask me why we never panicked, and the fact is we could have bounced off the walls for about 10 minutes, and when we finished, we'd be back where we started from. Our heart rates, of course, went up. Naturally, they would, but we decided that we better just, keep on charging.
It looks to me, looking out the hatch, we are venting something. We are venting something out into space.
Roger, we copy your venting. Okay, let's everybody think of the kind of things we'd be venting. GNC, you got anything that looks abnormal in your system?
Negative light.
How about you, Ecom? You see anything that could be venting?
Let me look at the system for you as far as the venting is concerned.
Okay, let's start scanning. Okay, now let's everybody keep cool. Let's solve the problem, but let's not make it any worse by guessing.
20 minutes into the crisis, Si Liebergott comes to the conclusion what's venting is the crew's source of oxygen. He accepts what his instruments have been telling him all along. Oxygen tank 2 is dead. Two of Odyssey's three fuel cells are dead. And oxygen tank 1, which is keeping the last fuel cell and the crew alive, is dying.
And that's when it hit. That's when I knew, because I accepted that the two fuel cells were probably dead and that I didn't have oxygen in tank number two anymore, and that the venting kind of tied into that. And then I'm looking at oxygen tank one, which is all we had left to live on and feed that final fuel cell, and I got less than 2 hours. That's when the panic hit, near panic. That's when I started at this. This is what you do when you're trying to reason with things.
Right, I've got a feeling we've lost two fuel cells. I don't know why we've lost them. It doesn't all tag up, and it's not an instrumentation problem.
The problem is real, and time is running out.
If we were going to save any elements of the spacecraft, time was going by. Time, the consciousness of time, and the awareness of the time, and the frustration at going 5, 10, 15 minutes into this process, and still not being at the bottom of it, still seeing the life's blood escaping.
Without the electrical power, the command module was dead. Without the electrical power and without oxygen, the crew were dead. That's how we were. We were on the point of losing everybody and everything.
From ABC News Space Headquarters, here is commentator Frank Reynolds.
There has been an emergency in the flight of Apollo 13. The prime objective of the mission, the landing on the moon, the further exploration of the lunar surface, has been canceled, and now the only consideration that remains is the safe return of the three astronauts.
Some kind of explosion occurred in the spacecraft's main engine. The explosion affected the spacecraft's main power system supplied by fuel cells. And that means that their oxygen supply is in jeopardy and their water supply is officially termed critical.
Hello, Paris. Ici New York. Eh bien...
News bulletins quickly circled the globe, and people everywhere stopped to consider the fate of three men who are drifting slowly away from the Earth, perhaps never to return.
When I heard about this explosive, first moment I said, it is finished. It was a very bad situation for all people on our Earth. Every people said, Господи, God, help to him, help to them, help to them.
Marilyn Lovell, who had been at Mission Control 15 minutes before the crisis began, didn't learn anything had happened until much later that evening.
I received a call from Jerry Hammack, one of the recovery people, and he didn't know that I didn't know, and he just said, I just want you to know that every country has offered help and to bring in the men back down, you know, to wherever they would splash down. And I said, Jerry, what are you talking about? Have you been drinking? I mean, I didn't know what he was talking about at the moment. And then he just had told me that, he said, I guess, you know, I think he tried to make it sound a little simpler for me so until someone could explain it to me, but he just told me they were having a problem with the fuel cells and what have you. And
my mother came upstairs, and she said, you know, there has been an accident, and everything's going to be fine. They're going to come back. They're not going to have a chance to go to the moon. And I remember feeling, my first feelings were for my father. You know, here he has been all this time, spending this time getting ready to go to the moon, and that dream wouldn't be met. And I was really upset for him.
I thought to myself, something's wrong. You know, my dad's never coming back. I'm never going to see my dad again. And, you know, he's basically, you know, I basically felt at that point that he was dead.
Across town, Mary Hayes, then 7 months pregnant, broke the news to her three children. Eldest daughter Margaret was then 13.
I was scared then because she was obviously upset about it. And she was trying to downplay it or not, you know, like it'll be okay, they'll get back. But you could just tell that it was worse than what she wanted to say.
It took 55 hours, 200,000 miles for the cracked wires in tank two to become exposed. Once they were and the tank fan was turned on, a spark between them ignited a fire. The tank exploded. Only the vacuum of space kept it from destroying the ship. Now, with a gaping hole and vital oxygen leaking into space, Apollo 13 is still racing to the moon. An hour and a half into the crisis, a fresh team takes over in mission control. Replacing Cy Liebergott is Clint Burton, who observes the continuing deterioration of the command module.
It hurts to be the bearer of bad news time after time after time. Nonetheless, it fell my duty to be that bearer of bad news time after time after time.
Ladycom, looks like we've got about 40 minutes left in that tank.
Okay, does it look like it's still going down?
That's affirmative, yes. Ladycom, go ahead. Okay, we've got an update on the time. Looks like we've got about 18 minutes until we get down to the cutoff point. Ladycom, temperature and the pressure correspond. So we're going to be there in 15 minutes.
In 15 minutes, the command module will no longer be able to support life. Fortunately for the crew of Apollo 13, their spacecraft has the ultimate in redundant systems, a second spacecraft, the lunar module. It has its own supplies of oxygen and electricity, enough to keep them alive for a while.
We found out that, that we'd probably lose all of our oxygen, knowing that we'd also lose our propulsion system, plus our electricity, of course. We decided that the only way we are going to save ourselves is use the LEM as a lifeboat.
Lovell and Hayes scramble through the tunnel into the LEM. Time is short, and they must activate power, guidance, and life support.
Go ahead.
Okay, back in the command module, Jack Swigert starts shutting things down. This will preserve the capsule's tiny entry batteries, which the crew will need if and when they get back to Earth, because the command module is the only part of the ship that can survive re-entry. Shutting it down now means it's going to get very cold, and that worries the team on the ground.
You did have a sense that this was the little home that it takes to get the folks back, and we were turning off all the lights. As a matter of fact, it was going to get very, very cold, and everything in it was going to be refrigerator or freezer temperatures when we came back. And we didn't know what the effect of any of that was going to be on the hardware. For example, the guidance hardware that we would need when we got to the reentry portion of the flight.
The guidance equipment in both the LEM and the command module was designed and built at MIT.
The guidance system is like your eyes and your foot on the throttle and your hands on the steering wheel. It's the information that gives you the ability to, if you will, steer from one point to another. And so the question was, is would the instruments be able to take the cold temperature? Would we be able to get the IMU back up and running? And the first impact was one of, oh my God, you know, these were things, answers we didn't have. And of course, there was a great concern. I mean, this was the national limelight, you know. We had three astronauts up there, and some of us had worked with some of these astronauts in training. So there was both a personal relationship that some people had in the organization with them, and then the whole concern about, could we get them back?
Until they know more, Gilmore's team urges Mission Control to leave the command module's guidance heater turned on. Lunny has his team figure out how much power that will use. The answer isn't what he'd hoped to hear.
0.8 amps for the rest of the mission. It's going to cost me 64 amp hours. I can't afford that.
Lunny orders the guidance system heater turned off. All they can do is hope the system will work when the crew needs it. Moments later, all the scrambling puts at risk the critical guidance data transferred from the command module. It's Lunny's worst moment of the entire night.
In the course of transferring the crew over to the lunar module, there was a period during the flight where I had this sense of a real emotional low, like a stomach falling out, because I allowed the
the thrusters on the command service module to be shut down before we were fully configured on the lunar module side.
The thrusters are little jets that keep the spacecraft from drifting out of control. If the ship drifts too far, the guidance computer can lose track of where it is in space.
Jack gets the word to completely power down, and we hadn't yet pressurized our reaction control system in the lunar module. Consequently, no one had control.
Apollo 13 starts to drift. It continues drifting for 2.5 long minutes. Finally, Lovell regains control of the ship, and the guidance system is okay. The situation is stable, but everyone at Mission Control knows Apollo 13 is still headed out to space with only enough supplies for a couple of days.
I felt relieved when they got into the limb and had systems in the limb that would provide life support, attitude control, and everything they need, at least temporarily. Even though that milestone had been attained, it wasn't absolutely clear to me at that time that we could pull it all together. It was the beginning of a solution, as far as I was concerned. It was a good beginning after a nightmare.
2,000 miles from Houston in Bethpage, Long Island, the men and women who built the lunar module learn about the crisis and rush in to do what they can to help.
The LEM was a flimsy-looking, spidery-type vehicle. The crew compartment had no amenities whatsoever. It didn't even have seats. And the construction was just as lightweight as it could possibly be. For example, the skin of the crew compartment was about 0.012 of an inch thick aluminum. That would be like three layers of Reynolds wrap put together. You could easily, if you were careless, put your boot or your foot right through that wall.
Kelly's task is to do an inventory of the LEM's consumables, like oxygen and electrical power, and determine how long it can support three astronauts instead of the usual two. He concludes the LEM can keep them alive for 2 days, but more than that will present problems. And at this point, no one knows exactly how long it will take to get 13 home.
I knew that the capability should be there, but my feeling was one of questioning whether we really had what we thought we had in the way of lifeboat mission capability.
3 hours into the crisis, Mission Control's focus shifts to the question of a course home. At this point, the most direct course may not be the best.
There were only two things, really, that you could do at that point. Being so close to the moon, you had to make up your mind, are we going to come back as rapidly as possible by using the engines on the command and service module or the lunar module? Or are we willing to take an extra 24 to 48 hours, let the thing be on a free return trajectory, let the moon bring us back from its gravitational pull, and can we keep the men alive safely for that length of time?
Turning around now would get the crew home in 2 days, but it's a high-risk strategy. It would use almost all the available fuel. Neither Kranz nor Lunny is willing to do that. They decide to go around the moon. It's a choice that has a lot of appeal to the astronauts.
At least we would be on a course that would intercept the Earth in some manner. Maybe not so much that it would be survivable, but it would probably be a much better aspect than being a permanent monument to the space program, you know, going back and forth for, I don't know, eons.
Before firing the rocket, the spacecraft has to be pointed in exactly the right direction. But the LEM was never designed to work with a command and service module attached.
I went to try to control the vehicle, and when I pitched down, it went into some wild gyration because the center of gravity had moved way out. If you pitch down on the attitude controller, the spacecraft is supposed to pitch down. If you yaw right, the spacecraft is supposed to yaw right. And it wasn't doing that at all. I mean, it was doing something unusual, something that you had never seen before, something that you had to then try to correlate in your brain of, hey, if I do yaw right, I know that it's not going to do that, but it's going to do something else. I had essentially learned to fly all over again. I mean, it was really starting from scratch.
Even as Lovell struggles to aim his ship, Mission Control sends up instructions for the burn, the first of its kind ever attempted in space.
Okay, Aquarius, you're ready to copy P-30 maneuver pad.
That's the firm.
Okay, here we go. The purpose is mid-course correction for free return.
They wanted to do it in 37 minutes. We were a little bit more cautious up in the spacecraft. Don't forget, at the rate we are going now, the course that we are on was going to get us within 60 miles of the lunar surface. And if we made the mistake of burning the wrong direction a little bit like that, we could just plow right into the lunar surface.
Lovell asks for and gets an extra hour to enter the data and prepare the ship. Then, at 2:45 Tuesday morning, almost 6 hours after the accident, Apollo 13 takes its first step on its long journey home.
5 seconds before the burn, there's a little indication on the computer that says, do you really want to make this burn? The computer is asking us if we know what we're doing. I hit the proceed button, which says, okay, computer, you got it. At zero, the engine goes on. Everything's working fine. It automatically shuts down. So there was a little bit of a high for us. I mean, you know, everything's going wrong. The command module is completely dead. And finally, we know that at least the brains in the lunar module are working so far, and we do get on what we thought was the free return burn.
Though still moving away from the Earth, 13 is now on a course for home. At its present speed, however, the astronauts will run out of power and water before they get back. With this in mind, Mission Control begins preparations for a second, bigger burn to be made after 13 loops around the moon. This big burn will cut 24 hours off 13's trip home. Even this may not be enough. Merlin Merritt is the controller responsible for the LEM's electrical and life support systems.
After the first hour or so, as we began to gather the data, and we saw those data points, heading down, it became obvious that within, an hour or so, that we weren't going to make it at that rate.
The biggest power consumer on the lunar module is the guidance system. Merritt feels it's essential to turn it off, but Lunny and Krantz feel just as strongly it has to stay up and running so the crew can position the ship before the big burn, which is 14 hours away.
There was never any question in my mind. I would have fought to the death to prevent anyone from trying to turn that platform down. That was essential to survival as water and air and electrical power.
We definitely weren't going to make it. I mean, we would not make it. So my position, of course, is to talk to the flight director. I said, Glenn, if we don't get this thing powered down, we're not going to make it. And, of course, Glenn was receptive, and I said, well, let's see your data. And so we called up our plots, and, once you looked at the data and the data was coming in, it was obvious we weren't going to make it.
Merritt's data is real, but Lunny and Kranz have a different, if drastic, solution. They will leave the guidance on for now, but after the big burn, the crew will be ordered to turn off virtually everything and coast home in darkness and cold. Houston, Tuesday morning, 10 hours after the accident.
Let's start here.
At a hastily assembled press conference, Chris Kraft offers a cautious appraisal of 13's situation.
It appears at the present time that everything is under control and that we have a safe situation at the moment.
I don't know whether
But Chris Kraft's idea of safety had been formed over years of risk-taking.
I'm used to people having difficulties putting their lives on the line and making it happen and doing the best they can. And that was sort of my shell, if you want to call it that. That was where I came from. I'd seen men killed. I'd worked with men that got killed.
Like Gus Grissom, Ed White, and Roger Chaffee, the crew of Apollo 1. In 1967, just 3 years before Apollo 13, they had burned to death during a pre-launch exercise.
The fire occurred while the astronauts were in the spacecraft at T-minus 10 minutes prior to the planned simulated liftoff.
For Jim Lovell, who helped bury his friends, what was particularly tragic was that the Apollo 1 crew died on the ground.
If you're going to, what we say, buy the farm, you might as well do it what you're testing. Cracking up in an X-15 or testing a new airplane getting lost in space, much better than going the way they went. Twenty-four hours after its accident, 13, wounded and battered, approaches the moon. The big burn that will speed its return home is just an hour away. Because the lunar module has less computing power than an average car has today, mission control does all the calculations for the burn. Detailed instructions are radioed up to the crew, which has to copy them exactly before they lose radio contact behind the moon. As the ground started to write up these procedures, I looked at Fred and Jack, and they weren't even listening to these procedures, but they had their cameras broken out, and they were looking at shutter speeds and aperture settings, and we're looking back at the moon. And I asked those guys, what are your plans here, gentlemen? And they said, well, we're going to take pictures when we go around the far side.
We knew that was the only time we were going to ever get to see the moon, so we kind of played tourist during that period.
Around the moon, Hayes and Swigert stay glued to the windows. But seeing the moon up close does less for Jim Lovell. He'd been here before, 14 months earlier, on Apollo 8. Apollo 8 was one of the great triumphs of manned spaceflight. It was the first time men had left the Earth to venture off into the galaxy. There were enormous risks. This was the first launch of a fully configured Saturn V. The first time NASA had relied on its deep space communications and tracking network. But the rewards were worth it. The crew of Apollo 8 became the first humans to see the far side of the moon.
For the last day on the way to the moon, the blunt end of our spacecraft was pointing towards the moon, so we never saw the moon as it got much bigger. I looked up in the windows and all I saw was black sky. That's all any of us saw until we rotated the spacecraft around about 180 degrees. And there, just 60 miles below, slowly slipping by, were the ancient old craters on the far side of the moon.
Apollo 8, Houston, what does the old moon look like from 60 miles, over?
Okay, Houston, the moon is essentially gray. No color. Looks like plaster of Paris.
While the moon looked uninviting, the blue Earth was a marvel to behold.
And from the crew of Apollo 8, God bless all of you on the good Earth.
Apollo 8 was a triumph, and Jim Lovell had played a key role in its success. Landing on the moon was all that was left for him to accomplish in the space program. Now, as his crippled craft floats above the desolate moonscape, he knows it is not to be.
I wished on the moon for something I never knew. Wished on the moon for more than I
As the moon slips by, Jim Lovell searches for a little mountain he had seen from Apollo 8.
I had named that little mountain Mount Marilyn after my wife. And of course, as we whipped around, that was one of the last things I saw. Sitting there was this little triangular mountain, Mount Marilyn.
Half an hour later, Jim Lovell fires the lunar module's engine for the big burn. Now it is time to pay the piper. The crew has to turn off virtually everything in the spacecraft. The next 3 days will present a severe test of both crew and equipment.
We knew early in the game that the powered down levels would approach survival of the crew and the survival of the system. The systems would get so cold that we were worried that possibly the batteries might freeze, the propellant in the command and service module lines would freeze. There was a good chance we would get the combined spacecraft home, but when we brought up the command and service module, it would be non-functional. It was the end of the road.
Without power, life in the lunar module becomes grim.
It gradually cooled on down to close to freezing in the command module, in some areas below freezing, because water tanks, for instance, froze. And I'd say 40 or slightly below in the limb.
We discussed dragging out our spacesuits, but then we thought more about it because they were, you know, rubberized inside, and that our perspiration would then be in there, and we'd actually be in a worse condition.
Closest analog would be if you're out, lost out in the woods on a hunting trip, and a cold front came through, and you're stuck out there for 4 days without a jacket.
Fred and I dragged out our lunar boots and put them on, and Jack just had to suffer, as all command module pilots do. You know.
The limb had no means of heating water. Most of the food packs of that dry food mixed with cold water doesn't mix very well and doesn't taste even less well.
So you have to remember that the lunar module was designed for two guys. We got three guys in there right now, and every time that I moved, it rattled Jack, and Jack rattled Fred, and then it reverberated back again, so we were going back and forth. So it got to be a miserable existence.
The tension and the cold make it almost impossible to sleep. And as if that weren't enough, there are new indignities for the crew. The ground asks them to stop dumping their urine overboard.
It was affecting their Doppler analysis of our trajectory and the flight path. And the real misunderstanding was, I'm sure they meant it in the sense of a certain length of time where they could get some tracking time, and we took it to really mean forever. So that put us on a search within the vehicles now to hunt virtually every container that made sense now to store the urine on board. At one point in the limb, I was hunting in one of the storage areas, which in the limb were nothing but canvas covers over things, and looking for food, if I recall. And I stumbled onto a little package that had been left in there from the family of pictures of the family that really was meant to be found or opened when we were on the lunar surface. So, there, you know, it was a feeling of, I, I hope someday I get to see him again.
The crisis on Apollo 13 is now into its second day. There's hardly a place on the planet that isn't aware of the astronaut's plight, or a person who isn't moved by the possibility that another human being might be lost in space.
If I may be serious for one moment and ask the entire audience for a moment of prayer for the crewmen of the Apollo 13. We'll hold silence for a moment, please.
Special prayers are offered from the Vatican to the Wailing Wall.
Would you like to say the Our Father for the astronauts right now?
Yes.
Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
For the astronauts' families, it's a time of hope and dread.
I didn't ask a lot of questions. I just stood in the background and listened. And when I did ask questions, they were just answered. You know, things are fine. They're really working on bringing them home.
Everybody was very careful not to have the radios or the televisions on. I mean, I was upset I couldn't go to school. And then, like I said, it just, there was absolutely, we didn't hear any of that. Because the news were, a lot of them were saying they're not getting back.
I never did go back to Mission Control, no. I think at one point when one of the doctors thought maybe that I could come over and talk Jim into getting some rest because he never did go to sleep. And I said there was no way that I could do that because I would just get over there and I would probably I'd probably break down in front of the world and everyone. So I decided that I couldn't do that, and I knew that he could do what he had to do himself.
She was very nervous, very upset, probably never stopped smoking, didn't sleep, and just really was, as far as, you know, like I said, you know, she didn't want to tell me what was going on. She didn't want to address it because she didn't want to believe it herself.
Earlier in the day on Tuesday, Mission Control had recognized another life-threatening problem. Deadly CO2 is accumulating in the lunar module.
CO2 in high concentrations in the atmosphere can be poisonous and can cause dizziness, headache, and existing long enough and a high enough level can even cause death. So we had to do something about that.
The LEM is running out of CO2 filters. The command module has plenty, but there is a problem.
The problem was that we had these square canisters. And in the lunar module, the receptacle in which you put the CO2 filters was round because the lunar module used round canisters or filters instead of square ones. So our problem was, how do we connect this square canister to a system that will only accept round filters?
Smiley's team has to find a solution that uses materials the crew has on board, like the cardboard covers from their flight manuals, plastic bags from their space suits, and lots of duct tape. By early Wednesday, they have a prototype. It's not the sort of thing NASA usually builds. It takes a while just to figure out how to describe it to the crew up in space. It then takes the crew a tense 2 hours to find and assemble all the pieces. It's a flimsy-looking contraption, but it will rid the cabin of CO2. One deadly problem is put to rest.
As soon as we put it together and hooked it up to the environmental system, the pressure went way down and we knew that this thing had worked.
For the next 24 hours, the crew can do nothing to help themselves. They must simply endure the cold and discomfort. Their concern with the storage of urine and the shortage of water has led them to drink less and less. This takes a toll. They're all dehydrated, and Fred Hayes develops a bladder infection. By late Wednesday, he's starting to drag, and by Thursday, he can barely stop shivering.
And finally, you know, it dawned on me that how sick he was. I ended up putting my body around, wrapped him around him to try to keep him warm because he was visibly shaking, you know, with the chills.
2 days of cold and misery has left the crew exhausted and drained. Apollo 13 is still more than 24 hours from splashdown, and these hours promise to be some of the most stressful of the entire flight.
You could almost feel them tailing off from a standpoint of their performance, but I never really understood how desperately cold it was out there and how those people were very close to freezing.
For the past 3 days, the recovery team has been preparing for splashdown in the Pacific. Even if 13 survives re-entry, no one can be sure where it will come down. It could land anywhere in an area of 500 miles by 250 miles.
We've got to find it, and you got C-130 aircraft at high altitude in the area that have a direction-finding capability. Closer in, on board the carrier, we have a helicopter squadron, which all has been configured with special antennas to do some direction-finding as well. As long as we got some electronic bearings, I think we'd have been all right.
That's assuming the capsule lands upright in the water and that its radio beacons are working. But it's quite possible 13 will have no power for its beacons. In that case, it will be almost impossible to find.
Basically, even if you were in a helicopter like a quarter mile away from the spacecraft and it was inverted, you had no electronic aids and you couldn't see anything. You really, if there are any white caps whatsoever, you couldn't see the spacecraft. It was that invisible out in the ocean.
Re-entry is now less than a day away. At Mission Control, the spotlight is on the first row of consoles, the trench. That's where the guidance officers work. They're worried about 13's trajectory. Something is forcing the spacecraft off course. This could have disastrous consequences.
Coming home from the moon, you had to come in and hit the atmosphere in a re-entry corridor that was only 2 degrees wide. A pie-shaped wedge, not any less than 5.5 degrees, not any greater than 7.5 degrees. You had to come down that 2-degree wedge. If you came in too shallow, you'd skip out, like skipping a stone on water. If you came in too steep, well, that sudden deceleration would make you a fiery meteor over the sky for a few brief seconds. We were coming in too shallow.
What is happening that we don't understand? Is it something in our computational processors? Is it something associated with the platform alignments we did? Is there something associated with maneuver execution? Why? It was one of those lurkers that you always wonder if it's gonna come up and bite you at the wrong time. If there's something that we've overlooked, and here we had zero margin for error. We could not overlook anything, and therefore we had to have an explanation for everything that was happening.
But the trench has no explanations. They don't know why the trajectory is shallowing, but they do know with only hours before re-entry, they have to do something to correct it. With some trepidation, the trench orders a course correction. With the guidance computers shut off, this promises to be a real test of the astronauts' skill. The crew will have to keep the Earth centered in the lunar module windows.
I told Jack, you're going to tell us exactly when to start the burn, and you'll time it with your wristwatch. And I told Fred, I said, you have a backup attitude controller. I have a primary. I know that when that engine goes on, that I'll never be able to keep the Earth in the window by myself, because these are what we call three attitude controllers in pitch and roll and yaw. I said, you take your attitude controller and keep the Earth from going back and forth too much. I'll take my attitude controller and keep the Earth from going up and down too much. He said, fine. And then over on the side, I had a couple of buttons. One said start, and one said stop. These were buttons that directly connected the battery to the descent engine, the one and only time they were ever used in the Apollo program to really start the engine just by direct electrical linkage. At the proper time, Jack said start. I hit the start button. The engine went on. I think we only had it for about 10% thrust, something like that. 14 seconds later, Jack said stop. I hit the stop button. And in between that time, we juggled the Earth, you know, up and down and sideways. And then, of course, we waited.
They wait for mission control to collect enough tracking data to find out whether their ship, slowly spinning to equalize exposure to the sun, is back on course. With 13 now so close to home, the time is fast approaching when the crew will have to get back in the frozen command module and try to restart it. Before they can, Mission Control has to devise and radio up a set of instructions, a checklist. A team led by 27-year-old John Aaron has spent the past 4 days working on one, trying to figure out how to start the command module and how to make the limited battery power on board last for the rest of the flight.
How do you go in with these little entry batteries, which are just designed to do 45 minutes worth of business, and do something that even our initial estimates has got to take 5 or 6 hours? The initial impression by the team, in fact, we had a bunch of people in the room and we were going around doing a combination of engineering and Carenza rating, it was easy to jump to the conclusion that maybe this was impossible. Everybody wanted power. The propulsion guys wanted power. The guidance guys wanted power. The attitude guys, I mean, everybody wants power. It was a fundamental constraint.
10 hours before projected splashdown, Aaron and his team are still working on a detailed checklist that will tell the crew which switch to throw and when. They have checked, rechecked, and run computer simulations and are still not sure it will work.
So I'm calling down and saying, I would certainly like to have that checklist up here because I knew it was going to be a very long thing and we're going to have to copy down, and Swiker was going to have to be doing all this sort of stuff. And I wanted to maybe to get it up and maybe have a couple dry runs and, you know, things like that. And of course, you know, by this time, they're having a lot more confidence in our survival, which I thought was kind of nice. And they said they'd have it up by Saturday. Yeah, we were going to be back there by Friday. You know, could you please, you know, pretty please send up the checklist so my rookie, you know, command module pilot could go through it and start throwing the switches.
On Friday morning, 4 a.m., the command module startup checklist is finally ready. Apollo 13 is now less than 9 hours from re-entry. It's hurtling toward the Earth at 20,000 miles per hour. It takes Swigert 2 hours, 40,000 miles, to write down all the detailed instructions. He uses the backs of notebooks and every scrap of paper the crew can find. 6 hours before re-entry, Swigert climbs back into the command module and starts throwing switches. Even now, no one knows whether it will start.
We had froze that mothership for, 4 days beyond its design limits, because it wasn't meant to be frozen, turned off and frozen, literally. So there was still, in my mind, concern about the condition of the capsule. You know, it ain't over, it's over.
To everyone's immense relief, the command module flickers back to life. But there's no time to celebrate. Every moment counts. Everyone is cold and exhausted. Hayes's fever has increased, but at this point, adrenaline takes over.
It was the big ball game, sort of sense, and I was ready to do what I had to do. When you're in that situation, you don't sense your own condition.
First, the crew has to get rid of the dead service module. Lovell and Hayes are still in the LEM. Lovell worries his rookie command module pilot might jettison the wrong part of the spacecraft.
I'm in the lunar module with a camera, and I tell Jack, not once, not twice, but three times, I said, Jack, we're jettisoning the service module, not the lunar module. Don't jettison the lunar module. You know, put some tape over that switch.
Once the service module is cut loose, the crew will get its first and only chance to see what happened to it.
He jettisons the service module, then I pull the command module and the lunar module together away, and then maneuver a little bit to see if I can see this service module as it sort of just drifts away from us. And sure enough, it comes into view, and as it rotates very slowly, one whole side of that panel was blown off.
Right by the eye gate antenna, the whole panel is blown out, almost from the base to the engine.
Copy that.
It's really a mess. Man, that's unbelievable.
We're actually sort of excited to see this thing, to find out, to give us some evidence of what really went wrong. You know, because you always have that thing in the back of your mind, well, gee, maybe... did I screw up someplace along the line to cause this all to happen? I mean, you have to bring home some evidence saying, hey, really, folks, it wasn't my fault. Take a look at this picture. You know, something happened back there, and I wasn't back there.
Hearing how much damage has been done to the service module leaves everyone in mission control with the same worry. Is 13's heat shield, which was just above the explosion, still intact?
Any penetration of the heat shield would have very possibly allowed a heat leak, plasma leak, and eventually a burn through during the process of entry. There wasn't anything about this entire mission that was a free ride.
Reentry is now 50 minutes away. It's time for Lovell and Hayes to leave the lifeboat. They join Swigert in the command module, lock the tunnel behind them, and wait for the order to jettison the LEM.
Odyssey Houston, we just had a formal go for LEM jet at your convenience, over.
Okay, thanks, Joe.
LEM jet.
Okay, copy that. Farewell, Aquarius, and we thank you.
She sure was a good ship.
Well, I was sad to see it go. And if I could have brought it back, I'd like to put it up in my backyard.
The command module is now on its own. To the dismay of everyone, it's still drifting off course. The guidance controllers must decide immediately what to do. They order a minor correction, guessing that either the LEM or the service module has been the cause of 13's drift. Did they guess right? They'll know when the rest of the world does, when and if they see Apollo 13's parachutes.
I know all of us here want to thank all you guys down there for the very fine job you did. That's a firm, Joe.
Tell you, we all had a good time doing it.
You have a good bedside manner.
That's the nicest thing anybody's ever said.
13 is traveling 24,000 miles an hour when it enters the Earth's atmosphere. 19 seconds later, radio contact is lost as the craft is enveloped in flame. Blackout is expected to last 3 minutes.
We're now coming to the moment, the last moments of Apollo 13 as it comes in, as it begins its re-entry. The best thing we can do now is just to listen and hope.
We'll only know whether or not that heat shield was damaged by the explosion 3 days ago. When they come out of radio blackout, all anybody can do now is cross their fingers.
Test
Just about now, they should be going through the moment of maximum heat.
30 seconds to go for blackout.
One of those times when there's nothing we can do, and seconds become minutes, and minutes become hours, and if you haven't heard, boy, it gets you right in the stomach.
Three minutes come and go, and there's no word.
Absolutely uptight, tense, on the edge for 4 days, and then to see that wonderful sight of the vehicle lumbering down through the atmosphere, hanging on the chutes. It's just, well, I'll never forget it.
I still feel the emotions within my body that will probably never, ever leave me, because I didn't know for 4 days if I was a wife or a widow.
Time that you see chutes, you'll see the cheering and the American flags come out. And then it's again tradition that you wait until the crew gets in the carrier deck, at which time cigars and the world map lights up. And, shit. It was neat.
You guys worked hard to bring this one
home. Jim Lovell, Fred Hayes, and Jack Swigert never got another chance to walk on the moon.
Come on out here and give me a big Navy salute.
Look at this.
Off the ground, I'm on board.
But eight other Americans did journey to the lunar surface. The last of them blasted off from the moon over 20 years ago. Still, the Apollo legacy lives on. The quest to set foot on another planet was one of history's greatest adventures, and people all over the world shared in the excitement. But Apollo 8, 11, and 13 did more. They brought the world together in a way we never expected. Venturing away from the Earth, we learned a fundamental and enduring truth. Earth is our only hope.
We had visited a very alien and very hostile and lifeless planet, and we saw the Earth as the only home that we know of within our near space capable of supporting life. And we recognize the absolute necessity to protect and nurture and take care of this environment.
Funding for Apollo 13 to the Edge and Back was provided in part by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by annual financial support from viewers like you. Apollo 13 to the Edge and Back is available on home video cassette for $19.95 plus shipping and handling. To order, call 1-800-255-9424.
This is PBS.